Stephanie Bosch is a public speaker with a master's in global leadership from Goldsmiths, University of London, and a BA in banking. Stephanie is an executive coach, British Psychology Society registered user for personality and ability testing, and a certified practitioner of Hogan Assessments. In this interview, she's going to tell us about some of the personality traits that make for effective leadership within the corporate world. And Stephanie is represented by stellar speakers. And so if you're interested in having Stephanie come speak at your event or within your company, then go to stellarspeakers.com. Also, if you're interested in coming on my podcast as a guest, go to benlowrey.com/podcast guests. And if you're interested in sponsoring the podcast, go to benlowrey.com/sponsorship. So welcome to the call, Stephanie. How are you today?
I'm very well. Thank you so much for having me. And I hope you're well too.
Well, you're welcome. And I'm looking forward. You're going to tell us about our dark side. So tell us about that. What does that mean?
Well, dark side, as we define it, is how does your behavior change when you're under pressure, when you are stressed, when you're in extreme situations and no longer are really fully aware of how you act, how you react, how you behave. And when we tend to sometimes even ruin our relationships, but are really ineffective in our communication and in our behavior with others.
Interesting. Now, I know you are a speaker, but are you some kind of therapist as well? What is your background? Where does all this come from?
Well, so I'm not a therapist, but yeah, my background is 12 years corporate land. I started off back in 2006 with a Deutsche Bank and with a dual kind of like education where you study full-time but also work full-time. So I did my undergrads in business administration, banking, with Deutsche Bank, stayed there for 6 years, and then went into management consulting, recruiting. And when I came over to London a few years ago, I went back to university to do my master's degree. And the master was an MSc in global leadership, which was mainly occupational psychology, though, from the content. And this is where I got in touch with this whole world of personality testing. I've used psychometrics already before during the management consultancy time, so back in 2012, I think it was. But yeah, learning from the scientific part of personality, item response theory, etc. So I got into in touch with the whole dark side of personalities and the research around it, and became a certified test user for personality and ability testing by British Psychology Society, and then got some further qualifications, also being a certified trainer. And yeah, so this is, I think, the dark side is, or explore your dark side is my sweet spot of what I know, but also what I've experienced myself, and what I just love talking about and also coaching about.
This is a great topic, and I'm hoping that we'll have time to really get into some of the details. Let me just start off. Tell us about some of the different you talked about psychometric testing?
Psychometric testing.
So give us an overview for people that don't know about the different personality types and what they mean and what impact it has on the workplace and relationships.
Personality types, most people have probably heard of something like MBTI, Myers-Briggs. And those are quite easy psychometrics where you are able to complete them in a short amount of time. And the categories where you put people into, the categories are quite broad. So you would usually have only either four colors with a different module, or you would have with the MBTI, you would have four letters that describe a person. The psychometric I use is Hogan Assessments, and we don't really have this whole, label we put onto people, but we'd rather go into more detail because we believe that personality is not that easily grasped.
So how long does it take to assess somebody's personality type? What did you call it? The Hogan method?
Hogan Assessments, yeah.
Is that the same as Hulk Hogan?
No.
Okay.
So the Hogan Assessments is it's three assessments in the combination I use it, and it's three different types of behavior we assess. So one is the bright side, which is your behavior on on autopilot, so when you are in everyday situations. Interestingly, though, we assess it from the, although it's a self-report, but we assess the side of like reputation. So how are you being perceived by other people rather than what do you think about yourself? So this would take 15 to 20 minutes to complete. Then the second one we combine it with is the dark side assessment. So this is the Hogan Development Survey. Again, reputation. So how are you being perceived by others when you're under pressure, when you're stressed, when you're in extreme situations? And then the third aspect, again, all three do take like roughly between 15 and 20 minutes. So it's between 45 and 60 minutes to complete the whole assessment. And the third one would be MVPI, which is like motives, values, preferences. So this is really the identity part, what makes a person tick and what makes them thrive, what is important to them, what kind of environment do they best fit into. And all those three combined give a very good understanding of a person's personality. However, it would only be an analyze, like an sorry, an analysis. And so the debriefing would follow afterwards, where we would then go into, giving a feedback to the person, but also having a chat, diving deeper into examples. So when does this behavior show up, etc. So altogether, just the first step would take roughly 3 hours with like filling up the assessment, and then later on, a 1.5 to 2 hour debriefing session.
So let me see if I understand this. So according to the Hogan method, there's three main components. So there's the way you other people perceive you in normal everyday tasks. That's one thing. There's the way people perceive you when you're stressed or under pressure or something. And then the final one is more your internal, like who you are in relation to yourself. Is that right?
Yeah, so what makes you tick, what is important to you? And the reason why we assess not identity mainly, but reputation is because although it's all of it is a self-report, however, due to like all this research that is done, so it's a valid and reliable assessment, we can have more or less like a 360 degree based on like a feedback that based on your answers you give. So you answer the assessment yourself, but based on the empirical studies, etc., behind it, we can still have a reliable answer of how are you being perceived by others. And then we have a global benchmark where we would see, okay, so you think, or like you are being perceived by others as someone who's quite prudent, for example. And then I mean, that's quite, it's still quite vague. So we would have a global benchmark that would measure how much more prudent are you compared to other people. So by making it all more like reliable and also more tangible, it just gives a better understanding of how you're being perceived by others. And also identity is quite difficult to assess because most people don't really know themselves too well anyway. So
So,
yeah, this is the main one of the main reasons.
and why is this important in the corporate world? Like, give us an example of how you would practically, be asked to use this, in the corporate world.
Well, I mean, there's different usages for. So you could use it in a recruitment kind of context to see how much risk would a person bring into an organization. But you could also use it within leadership development or in general development, people development, because when we assess reputation, this is where we get the blind spot. Like we light up the blind spot so we understand where are potential performance risks, so we can then identify them and manage them or maybe even avoid them before they become a real problem.
So give me an example of what you mean by blind spot.
So for example, if I don't, so I'm usually, if I'm not a reflective person, if I'm not really self-aware, and there's actually a really interesting study that most people think they're very self-aware. However, only 10 to 15% of people really are. So if I think, for example, I'm very trustworthy and I'm a very great person, then this is my very own opinion. I don't really have, though, maybe a comparison to others. So I don't really know compared to other people how integer am I, etc. So we say that the whole aspect of performance is based on your reputation. There is a quote which says that people hire us, marry us, or fire us based on what they think about us. So if I, for example, go to a bank and apply for a loan, and if I believe that I'm really trustworthy and I can pay the money back and I will pay the money back, then still I would have to, or like the banker has to believe the same way. They have to trust that I am the right person who deserves to get a credit or like a loan. And so this is all this whole aspect of reputation rather than identity.
Can a person be in a position where they've got a very different idea of themselves than how the rest of the world sees them? And can that be a problem? Can that be distressing or leave them confused? Is that a common scenario?
Well, I mean, definitely it can be, and this is another program I speak about, and it's called Ditch Your Mask, because often we put on a mask to fit in. I would say, especially like this whole, I don't feel like belonging. I feel like a misfit. I feel like I don't really fit into this whole thing. Will often happen when people are not really aligned with their values. So, for example, if it turns out that I am a very traditional person and that like long-lasting relationships are important to me, that I'm very focused on stability, etc., then I might not be the best person to join a startup, a high-risk startup, for example. If I would do it though, I might feel that I'm kind of like not aligned with who I am and what I'm doing, if that makes sense.
Yeah, that does make sense. And so, at what point did you decide to begin explore your dark side? Tell us how that came about.
Well, I think it was for me quite an early age. So I moved a lot in my life. So I think the first time I moved was when I was a year or two old. And so I always had to make new friends. We kept moving every few years. And so for me, I was always very interested in relationships and communication, in making friends. But because I never really had like these stable roots, so I was always trying to fit in quite quickly and to please people. And so much so that I somehow lost myself along the way. And I think this was like where the natural kind of tendency came up for me to be interested in, in how people function, what makes them tick, and why sometimes relationships don't work, and why do we click with other people, etc. And then when I went into management consulting, I got the first time in touch with like executive coaching or with coaching in general. And I found it very interesting how psychometrics can inform our decisions or can inform how our beliefs, our perceptions. I'm not saying that, just doing psychometric and everything is done. It's just a starting point for the journey of self-discovery. But I find it quite interesting as a person who's, former banker, I think I'm quite nerdy about numbers and data and facts. So yeah, I think this was like already the interest that was sparked. And then when I did my master's degree, I mean, I was obviously studying global leadership, so leadership was always a big component. But I think also the combination of having had not only great leaders in my own experience, but also some quite bad managers. I think this was just where I was like, okay, what happened? What's going on? Why are some people outstandingly positive or outstandingly great in what they do and people like to follow them? And why would others only be followed because they have a title or because they have this given authority?
So tell us, what makes someone likable? Like you just mentioned leaders that people like to follow. So what is it about them? Why is that?
I think, well, I mean, likability, I think it depends on whether likability is the only criteria, and I don't believe it is, because in my opinion, leadership is not just a popularity contest. It's good if you have a person, obviously, you like, but I think leadership is a responsibility, and I feel we are most drawn to people who are not only authentic, but like who are truly authentic, and I know this word is kind of like overused in recent times, but also people who are able to make a tough decision, to really lead by example, and to who are honest, who back up their teammates. So people who are being liked in the sense that they're living up to the expectations people put onto them. Not necessarily in the sense, you know, you're my favorite person, because you never say, you never make a tough call, or you never give me tough love, or whatever it might be. But rather people who keep their teams safe. I think this is the word I was looking for, keeping their teams safe and, be there for them when they need them.
So protective, loyal, trustworthy, are those all the kind of traits you mean?
Yes, I think so, yeah. But again, I think it's sometimes a bit difficult to put on labels, because we have to look about, like, you know, personality is one thing, but also in what kind of context are we operating, and what kind of behavior is needed. So I was recently talking to someone from the military. And being a soldier's daughter, I mean, I've obviously got a relationship to the military, but I was always wondering, how would people be able to make life or death decisions in really tough environments like battlefields? And how could these leaders keep their teams safe, etc.? And I think sometimes, you know, can you always make the right decision? Can you always be... obviously you should always be the ethical person, but sometimes I think we need to also be able to make a tough call. And this could be sometimes, I think, very difficult for people who overthink it, because, you know, they want to be seen as this person who is who's never making any mistakes, etc. So I think I definitely think that, like, loyalty is right, but how loyal are you? Would this mean you suffer and stay on with the company, although you no longer believe in the cause, etc.? So I think these characteristics or personality traits are definitely important. But again, I think it's important to question, is it still the right cause, or the right organization, or the right people you are loyal to? Or should you move on?
Who are some people that you've worked with, or people that you look up to, that you admire, that you believe are great people, great leaders? Could you give us an example?
Yes. So I think one was my my boss at Deutsche Bank. And unfortunately, we didn't really have too much time working together, because I already had it handed in my notice, because I was just ready to leave after 6 years. But yeah, I think if I would have met him earlier, I would probably have stayed, because he was someone who, he would totally not fit the typical, I would say, like, corporate leadership persona. He was very authentic. He was, with authentic, I mean, he would not really watch his language. He would say, you know, just what he needed to say, but he would just say words with love. So he would always make sure that the people he's managing are very well taken care of. And he would pick a tough fight if he had to with management. He would back up decisions. He would back up decisions and mistakes his teams might have made, because he really stepped into this responsibility of leadership. And he would also give praise to people where praise was due. So I think he was one of the people that were very down to earth, not anyone, you know, getting respect from their title. They got a lot of respect, but I think especially in corporate environments, there's often this kind of element of fear when you speak to a leader or to a manager. It's always like you get caught into the office and you'd be like, oh God, he wants to talk to me, or she wants to talk to me. And you have, like, this slight element of fear. And with him, it was just, you know, you were okay to go there because you knew it wouldn't be that bad. Mm. And I think he was someone who changed the culture of the bank to a very positive kind of environment. I'm not saying that it was bad before, but you could just feel how people would suddenly just hit their targets, outperform their targets, and they had just they gained so much more fun in their work because they just felt so empowered, but also backed up by the decisions they made. And the other person I think that I'm very inspired by is a client of mine who again doesn't really fit the it's a he's a partner at the Big Four company, and he doesn't really fit the neither the CV nor the appearance of a typical like management consultant, but he's very down to earth. He's very, very capable, and he cares just so much about his team, which I just think is really, really great.
So caring is an important quality then?
Well, I think, again, it depends on the environment. So management, consulting, banking, etc. are industries where I think caring is not necessarily very often lived. If you come from more social kind of environments, you often have a more caring element anyways in place. So they might need, for a great leader, different different attributes and different sets of personality characteristics to become a great leader and to make a difference.
So when you are asked to come and consult, is it usually the company that's bringing you in to work with one of their employees to get the best out of them? Or is it the individual themselves that's seeking you to help them in some way?
Yeah, so I mainly work with the individuals themselves. I would love to work more, obviously, with companies in the future. But I think coming from Germany, HR is still sometimes a bit, a bit conservative in their approach. And, you would always go with the, often go with the big companies. Like there's a saying that no one ever got fired for hiring IBM. And entrepreneurship and being a small company, having only a small team is something that is, especially back there, is it's not that celebrated, I think, as it is in the UK. So it's a mix of individuals and companies. But I hope that more companies would pick up also, assessing the risk a person brings in or the risk of a hire, especially when we look at higher positions, and also maybe move away from this black and white thinking of good and bad, because sometimes we might need some tougher traits to get ahead and to keep up the performance up.
As somebody who studied psychology formally, what's your view of Tony Robbins?
Well, I studied formally global leadership with loads of elements of occupational psychology. I think what he has done brilliantly is having a very big following and having created a very big reach. And loads of the work he does, obviously, is for the better. So he does work a lot on the mindset, etc. And I think it's a good thing to wake people up to take responsibility for their own behavior and to take responsibility for their own lives and work on their mindsets. However, I sometimes feel that, just looking at those events, for example, it's also kind of like setting the stage for people to obviously being quite receive the messages properly. And also there's quite some selling going on, maybe sometimes even like hard selling. And I think it depends on which kind of perspective you're coming from. Are you coming from a marketing perspective? Are you coming from the mission? I know he does give back a lot of money also for charity, for good causes. Is it good? Is it ethical to sell when people are really ready to work on themselves and are in the state of mind? So I think it depends on what kind of aspect we are looking at. And I mean, most of people wouldn't invent the VLNU, right? So loads of the information he teaches, some of them have been there already before. Some of them coming from different other practitioners and are recycled. So I think Yeah, he's reaching a lot of people, and I think loads of the products or loads of the advice he's giving is absolutely valuable. However, I feel like just sometimes it's so, for example, healing a relationship within 5 minutes while on stage. I mean, there's always all the time, of course, as well, pressure. You know, you've been caught up, you getting asked to tell about your problems, etc. Yeah, I think there is a pressure to be like, oh yeah, now that now all feels better. So I mean, there's this whole marketing element as well, which is very strong and very, yeah, I think very present in this whole scenario.
Yeah, I agree. Also,
What do you think of him?
I like him. I've attended his seminars, and everything you said I agree with. I mean, he's very talented. He's got a lot of charisma that comes very naturally to him. And yeah, he does a lot of good. He does sell hard. There is a lot of marketing and a lot of products and courses and seminars that are promoted, and they're all quite expensive. So yeah, overall I do like him. Yeah, I think he does good work.
But I think it's also like, especially like the selling element, for example, I think it's also a cultural thing, right? Like in the States, there's a bit more noise in the market. So selling is just way more natural as it would be, for example, in Germany or in the UK, where people are more holding back and introducing themselves and their products maybe in a less obvious way.
Yeah, I agree. There is a
Yeah.
difference. Yeah, the
Yeah.
Americans are less ashamed to sort of promote themselves and talk
Yeah.
about how great they are. Yeah, I agree.
However, sorry, we can move on in a second, but I just want to say one thing. I think what does work really well as well is, and this saying this as a speaker, I think the way he crafted his own story and how he makes it relatable to other people and makes it for them achievable to overcome their own obstacles, I think this is actually really brilliantly done.
Does a person need an element of struggle and vulnerability in order to make them likable?
Well, no. I think often people like to see like this, we all like hero stories, and I think we all like to see an underdog and see someone like us can get it. But I think there's a big danger in having these like me, 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 and pity parties when we are on stage and just like leveraging our own struggles and having like it doesn't really define our worth, right? How much struggle we went through. But I think it's important that we, when we speak about it, that we make it relevant for the audience, that we are able to draw the lessons, learn from it. And no matter what it is, I think all of us have suffered in their lives and all of us had rough times, some more as others. But the moment when we are in pain, it's the worst pain we are in because to us, that's the only pain I think we can feel. Even if we're empathetic, but if you tell me, for example, how I don't know, if you broke your leg or anything, I can feel sorry for you and I might can imagine that it's quite painful, but you had the pain moment in this moment. So I think yeah, we all need struggle and we all it's just part of life. I think we all have these little fights to fight. But I wouldn't say it's necessary to be likable. I think it's relevant to for people to relate to people who are similar to them.
I
So
see.
that Seth Godin said it quite beautifully. He said, people like us do things like this. So it's about with whom can I identify, with whom can I yeah, I think build a true connection or find belonging.
I see. So we see similarities in others. Is that what you mean?
Yeah, I think it's similarities and maybe aspiration as well. So if I have a similarity, but I could also, for example, have a role model, so someone I might want to grow into, or aspects of a person that I admire, I think
Right.
this would work as well. Yeah.
All right. Okay. Now, mental health is, it seems to be quite a popular topic lately. A lot of people are talking about mental health. Why is that? And what's your view of it? And is it an important conversation? What do you think?
Absolutely important conversation. I'm not quite sure though how popular it really is. I think loads of people have, think that it's relevant to speak about. However, I've done a few interviews and there's still some stigma around different sort of like mental health and mental illnesses. I think it's totally okay to speak about stuff like burnout, stress, maybe depression, but I feel like when it comes to different other areas of behavior or like mental health, mental illness, it's still something we kind of like not really speak up as much as we maybe should. So, for example, suicide prevention, self-harm, borderline, schizophrenia, autism, etc. So I think there's so much more where we just pretend, yeah, of course it's important, like mental health, etc. But you know what? We are like in our organization, no one is doing it or no one is having it. We are all healthy, we are all okay. And I think it's still very difficult to open up when you struggle with mental health and when you struggle with your own mental illness. And coming from a very own personal perspective, I mean, well, that's quite personal now, but I'm self-harming, or I was self-harming since I was 14 years old, struggling quite severely with depression. And my mask was so perfectly on that people wouldn't even realize when I was in a very quite severe depressive phase. So I think this whole like asking someone, how are you? And we just expect an I'm a fine, because we don't really are willing to listen to people. I think there's still loads of potential to actually open up the conversation. And also I think there's loads of potential to help people getting real support and real help, rather than telling people you will be okay, don't be so sad, you will be okay, etc. But really to take it seriously if someone is struggling. And I think the main moment when so for example, when suicide is being talked about, is usually when a celebrity like Chester Bennington or Kate Spade, when they end their lives, we have this short conversation around it. But then we kind of like, move away again. So I think, yeah, it's an important topic, it's necessary, and I think there's loads of room for it to improve.
What's your view of masculinity, femininity, and within the workplace? What's your view of the difference between the male and female traits, and how does that find its way into your work?
Well, there's actually quite an interesting study, and it so the dark triad is based on the personality traits, psychopathy, narcissism, and Machiavellism. And I mean, all of us do have like parts of the traits in us, depending on how much, the context, etc. And some, like especially like fast-paced, high-pressure environments, tend to be drawn to recruiting people into the organization who show these kind of personality traits, but also or who are really good at interviewing or being interviewed, without maybe sometimes having a look on how good are they really at their job. So like impression management, etc., is quite important. However, there's a study where it says that women, for example, so the feminine personality of women, are like naturally more caring, like they are more like the caring kind of person who would, I mean, quite naturally look after the children, etc. However, the higher up they go into the hierarchy, and the more or the higher they scale on the dark triad personality traits, the less agreeable they become, which is quite interesting. So I think depending on, again, the role the role, the context, the organizational culture, their own personality. I don't think we should classify in masculine and feminine traits, but rather, because it's again, it's just labels, but rather move away and see who's the best person for the job. And maybe overthink our thinking of course, so this has to be a man, or because we need to hit the quota, we need to put a woman on this position, but rather really see, okay, who's the best qualified for the position. And I think there's like loads of men who are quite feminine in how they are in their personality, but also there are loads of women who are quite masculine. And I think again, also when we talk about gender, there's so much more in between. Should we really, really focus on it, or should we maybe rather try to open up spaces? And I mean, this is one side for corporate as well, but it's also obviously for being in nurseries, etc. Wouldn't it make sense to get like more men to work in kindergarten, etc., so they can get the more masculine role as well? It's for the children to grow up as role models, etc. So I think, I mean, there's loads of qualified women, there's loads of qualified men, there's loads of qualified people in between, and I think it's just really about diversity and also inclusion to make people feel welcome and have a look about who's the best for the person and what kind of traits and sets do we need. Do we need agreeableness? Yes, but do we need it always? No, because sometimes someone has to make it the tough call, especially when we're under pressure, when we are stressed, and someone has to lead and make a decision. If it's a wrong one, we can revise it, but if no one makes a decision, yeah, it's probably quite bad for the company.
Are men generally more suited to leadership roles, or is that a myth?
There's a very interesting book recently published, which is called "Why So Many Incompetent Men Become Leaders." so I would assume no, it's not. Like, men are not the best leaders, and I truly believe they are not. But again, I wouldn't necessarily say it's man or woman. It's the person. Who is the best person for this role? What does the person bring to the table? And what is expected of this role on and the role holder, obviously. But I think, yeah, people are just so very different that we are way more than just our genders.
Yeah. Okay. And so, when did you begin public speaking, and what kind of audience do you aim yourself at?
So it was actually it was probably not the most classical way on how I approached this whole thing. So I've already written it down. I started my business like 2.5 years ago, and I've written down in my business plan back then that I would like to speak, and that I would like to become a professional speaker. But I thought in my mind, yeah, you can only do it when you're like in your late 30s, and so this is why I postponed it. And last year in summer, I made the decision that, you know what, why should I wait? I just really want to do it. I have a message to spread, and I like speaking in front of people. So I was in Hungary with my husband and some other colleagues, and we went to, well, he was the interim HR director in Hungary, so we went there as a in his function as as an HR person. We went to the Pride Parade, and so we just sat afterwards. They had a drink, and I was talking about an article I just published, and the article was Leadership Lessons from Dr. Hannibal Lecter. And
Dr. Hannibal Lecter?
yes. So I'm looking like, again, what can we learn from the bad guys? I'm just, it's a different perspective on leadership. What can we learn from the bad guys about leadership, and help the good guys equip? Because I mean, psychopaths, etc., they are real, and they are in the workplace, etc. So yeah, well, anyways, I wrote this article,
Well, I'm
and
glad we can learn some positive personality traits from Hannibal Lecter. That's a relief.
I mean, for example, one trait, like what we could learn from him is He is an absolute master in disguise and his manipulating tactics, how he influences people, how he reads people. That's definitely something to learn and to be aware of because people do that in real life as well. And then we would go into gaslighting, etc. So, how can you telltale the signs when people are not truthful, when people are hiding, when people are manipulating others, etc. So, but obviously, I mean, this article was also a bit of like with humor. There's one about Darth Vader, etc. as well. So it's really like kind of a series of leadership lessons from either characters. But anyway, so we spoke about this in Hungary, and then suddenly the husband from a colleague of my husband, he jumped in and was like, "Oh, would you be open to do a speech about this in Romania?" And I was like, yes, of course, I'd love to. And so this is how I ended up with my first speaking engagement at a leadership conference, a 2-day leadership conference in Romania, and then took it from there. I got like some more training in, and yeah, this is where my journey started with speaking.
Now you've got a business relationship with Stellar Speakers, and this was our connection via Neil Fellow. So are they representing you, or are they just one of the speaking agencies that you work with?
Yeah, well, so I signed with them just recently, actually. But yeah, I met Kelly, so the founding director. I met her a while ago, roughly end of the year last year. And so yeah, this is where we got in touch, where we got connected, and now yeah, started working together.
Oh, fantastic. So, are you looking to do more and more speaking? And I'm imagining you're doing that simultaneously alongside your management consulting. Is that right?
Yes, however, in like the plan for the future is to really focus more on the speaking, and yeah, maybe get some more people in for the consulting bits, for the coaching bits, and so that I can focus more on the speaking. But yeah, at this time, it's yeah, both quite similar, well, sorry, simultaneously, and yeah, just see how it goes.
And what's your long-term plans for your career?
So I would actually like to, inform more people about leadership, about the dark side as well, about the importance of exploring one's own dark sides, to be really becoming aware of when we are not effective. I'm a massive believer that we should play to our strengths, but really need to know when is it too much. So what are the tripping points when we overuse our own strengths? And by helping people become more self-aware, by understanding their own performance risks, etc., I hope to make and this sounds really cheesy now, but I hope to make the corporate world a bit happier, a healthier, and a more human place, because I'm a massive fan of empowering people and to becoming their true, authentic selves. But I'm not in the team of you are perfect just the way you are, because I believe if we just keep telling people how fantastic they are, and they don't see any need in like working on improving on themselves, I feel it's often used to be not the nicest person as we could be and not the best version of ourselves.
Yeah, I agree. There's a kind of naivety with that, isn't there? If you constantly say everything's fine, then nothing, it doesn't really leave space for anything to be improved or for lessons to be learned from past mistakes. It kind of
Yes.
traps you in a way, doesn't it?
Yes, absolutely.
Can we expect a book from you?
Yes. I'm actually writing it at the moment, and yeah, so I hope it will be published. Well, I'm working on it, but I hope it will be published latest next year. So, yes.
And will it be called Explore Your Dark Side?
I'm not quite sure yet. It will be around, obviously, about the dark side. But most likely it will be, but I'm not 100% sure yet.
Okay. Well, Stephanie, thanks for coming on the podcast. That was very interesting stuff.
Thank you so much for having me, and for taking the time to talk to me.
You're welcome. All the best. So I'll put all your information on the description and people can come and find you.
Okay, awesome. Thank
All
you so
right.
much.
Okay. Bye, Stephanie. Thank you.
Thank you. Take care. Bye bye.
Bye.